Very nice to be here. Jesus, I feel so old when I look at you all. It's incredible. And even I wasn't here, huh? But I think it's very important for you to see this picture of Rotterdam. Maybe you've seen it many times before, but it is just, you know, it took 50 years to rebuild the inner city, and the inner city was bombed in one day. And 3 days firing, and then everything was gone. Eh? They just, what wasn't gone, they demolished also, because they had already a new plan. But it takes time. It takes time. My occupation takes also a lot of time. Trees grow very, very slow, even if we plant them big, like, we do on some places. Rebuilding inner city of Rotterdam. The plan was already there. 18 days after the bombing, people started already on the plan of how this new modern city should come alive again. And well, plans are always a bit boring to look at, but I tell you just the, what it means. It should be a modern city with hardly any housing, but a lot of shopping and retail and offices. And the people should live in much bigger apartments, having more spacious apartments, more light, etc. That was where they start working on. And then I came back to the Netherlands. I had been traveling about 15 years, and in 95, 96, I came back to Rotterdam. And I had been in a lot of beautiful places, nice places, also ugly places. And, they were all happy. Well, we just finished the reconstruction plan. Huh? It was 1995. It was really, now we're going to the other side of the river and we start to develop the Kop van Zuid. And I was a landscape architect, and I liked green, and I thought there is no green in the city. And there is a beautiful river, but you couldn't sit anywhere along the river on the quays. I was just surprised, and it was something else. I thought, wow, it's because, of course, it was a modern city. They could make big roads, and it was really interesting because you had everywhere four lanes, two lanes to go straight, two lanes to go to the left, two lanes to go to the right. And then there was a little space left, and that was for bicycles, not so wide as now, but it was smaller. And then there was hardly any place for pavement, for trees, for seatings along the boulevards. And there was no city life. And of course, I mean, you don't understand the city. If you arrive in Rotterdam, it's really hard to understand how it's working. And so I was really kind of surprised, and I was asking, and well, that was of course not a good moment. It was not a good timing, because everyone was very much into, well, going to Kop van Zuid. Everyone was very much into Barcelonese architecture and all the beautiful plazas and squares you could see in Barcelona. We all went on excursions, and of course it was very nice, but it was totally different from Rotterdam. Well, I was on the wrong time in that way, and I had to go south. I will start to work in Rotterdam South, because that's where you can learn very much about the city. And I just left the inner city in a way. And then there was this chance. It was a big city park. Who of you have been to Rotterdam South? Okay, that's really something, because a lot of times people don't, well, they go to the Kop van Zuid, but they don't go further. Well, just to give you an idea, here's the Ahoy complex, and here was this big park, 200 hectares in Rotterdam South. And South was in that time, and still South has some problems, but South was in 95 really a big problem. And of course they were very active on the Kop van Zuid, but there was this whole park. In that time, in the Netherlands, if people want to reconstruct a park, or there was no money for it, and what they did, it was always give away half of the park, and they would build in houses or offices, and then with the money they gained with that, they would reconstruct the park. And then I learned from Riek Bakker, because our aldermen and our people from the economy department, they all said, okay, make this park, make it only the half, just do this part. And then in the other part, we can make a lot of houses, attractive houses, we need houses. And then it will be all much better for South. And I had just learned from Riek Bakker that we should have another approach. And that was the first time that you start to think, okay, public space, it's nice to, it is important to make a aesthetical quality, that's nice for the people. But it's more than that. It's not only aesthetical quality. It can also help to improve the life of the people, their economic situation. And how did we do that here is by taking actually using the whole length of the park, and that's more than 4 kilometers. And from Riek told me, I think you know Riek Bakker, she's a famous city planner. She was in Rotterdam, she had just left then. And she said, well, if you used this whole length and you really make a nice and beautiful park, then all the houses along this park, their real estate value will raise with about 15%. And if you do that, then it will help to, well, that's the word they were using in that time, emancipation of South. Because you bring something more than just a good area where people can sport and play, etc. And that was really, for me, a kind of change. Because first, you were always kind of about the design and about the aesthetics. And then you saw there are more possibilities in it. Well, what you maybe can see on this drawing is that you see it's an old Volkspark. It was about 50 years old. And it had a lot of sporting fields with big anonymous green, really not nice green. It was not very well kept and maintained. And then on the other side, you can't even see them, but they were all allotment gardens. And then there was this public space kind of in between. And people didn't dare to go there and, well, didn't use it, although they had to go there because they had to pass it when they go to schools or to do shopping from this to this area. So what we did, we opened up the park by all these big clumps of trees. We make smaller, we made holes in it. And we made far more public space in it, open space, grassland, so people could use informal, play football, do all types of things. And we made different areas, so people could recognize where they were in the park, because all the green looked the same. Green can be really boring, actually, so it was all the same. You didn't know where you were, and so we started to work on that. Something else we did, and that was also a kind of economical approach, you could say, was we had these three ponds, and here was a small little water. And we made a much bigger pond up here, about 5 hectares. And that was not only to make a nice water pond, but also to reduce all the flooding. There was local flooding problems in the areas north of the park. So when there was heavy rain, all their basements would fill up with water. And that was a really problem. So we used the connection of the singles. And we made kind of storage place here, where the water was also cleaned. And the problems in the neighborhood were solved. And that really helped also to get the money for the park, because the park had a use, improve the real estate, solving water problems, and of course bringing more possibilities for people to move, to sport, etc. In the park. Well, I just tell you a little bit about one thing. We had, of course, a lot making this big pond. You have a lot of, you have to dig in a lot of soil. And from this soil, we made behind the Ahoy complex, we made Adventure Island for the children. These big hills from 8 to 10 meters, different hills, positioning them like you wouldn't see Ahoy in its whole, but just with a little bit more, well, collision, you could call it. And in between those hills, there would be areas where you could play and turn. And these hills itself, you could use, of course, for rolling off, for hide and seek, all types of plays. Here was also, if you make a playground somewhere, we have extremely amount of restrictions. Everything is danger, and everything is about insurance. So always, if you do something with playing, the first thing you have to think of is how's the paving? It should be soft. And if it is sand, then of course you have to be careful because the cats will do their poo in it. And it's really, really difficult. And we thought, and also with playgrounds, it's also if the children are not there on Monday morning, they're really desolated. And they're really kind of, you think, oh, you know, it's kind of, Playmobil thing. So we start working with children from the neighborhoods. Quite a few afternoons we worked with them, and they could make their ideal playground, but they were not allowed to make something they knew. They had to invent something, you know, not existing, and it could be as difficult as it was. And of course, they explained a lot all the time what was necessary, that they wanted to be able to climb, that they also wanted to be better than someone else, so there should be levels of difficulties in it. They wanted to swing, etc. And well, they made really fantastic maquettes, and then there was a winner, of course. And with that design, we started to work with one of the constructors, and he made this playground. And it's a kind of sculpture of wood, and there is a lot of strings in it, which are not on the picture. But it was really nice that we could use their ideas and make something which was allowed, and was also interesting when there was no one there. We also worked with someone with a sculpture. And again, we said we want to have sculptures also when there's no one there. They should be interesting, and they should also teach children to use their creativity. It's not like there is only one use for it. There should be different use. So she made, and we had a lot of discussions, of course, but she made these really nice stones possibilities to climb, and little ones could only go to here, and the bigger ones were really proud. This was my son then, that he was at the top. And also we made a huge water bowl, and with your feet there were little nipples, and then you could press it, and then the fountains would start to work on another place where of course someone else was standing. So it was a lot of fun. This is the last part of the park, because it's of course not only for parks, should be for everyone from between 0 and 100, I think. And especially in Rotterdam, we have many, many young people, in this age between 16 and, 35, and they do a lot of activities in public space. They don't always want to be with sporting clubs, into organizations. They want to have a space for free sporting. That was also something really came out all the interviews we did with the people. And we made this huge, it's kind of landscape of big slabs of concrete. There are a lot of slopes in it. And of course, all the skaters and all types of rolling sports are practiced there, and they're practiced there in the weekend and in the evenings. Well, then it was time to the park was kind of organized. It was set. People were using it, and it was time to go back to the other side of town, to go back to the inner city. And I started to work a little bit different, because it was the beginning of 2002, and what you could see that there was a lot of interesting and beautiful places in the city, and people were talking about them. But at the same time, the general quality of public space in Rotterdam wasn't very nice, and it was actually like this. And this was just everywhere. So the whole network of how streets were connected, it was very poor. It was poor, and of course there are many reasons. And public space, everyone is using it. Everyone is experienced. So it's like a football match. Everyone knows how it should be better. And there was a lot of complaints, and it really helped. It was not only we as professionals, but it was the developers. It were the inhabitants. It were the retailers. Tell people, they said, yeah, it's ugly, and you should change. And then I got a position that I could make a more long-term strategy for Rotterdam, because all the time we were just hopping from square to square or from street to street. And well, we thought we have to set more wider goals for the city to, for a long term. You can't change it just all in once. And we developed this manual, and it's called Rotterdam Stijl. Style, I can't translate that in English. And it is an and it's a manual everyone is now working with. And well, it sounds really easy, but it was a terrible process, because everyone had, of course, a different opinion. And there was certain times they call me and my group the Rotterdam Style police, because we are really sticking to the plan. But what we did was making a vision, really, from what is important for the city on long term, how do we have to work on it, etc. We made these two books, Design Principles. So if you work on a street, that you know what type of architecture, what type it is built, what is the use of the street, etc. And we made a toolkit, and that's about the materials, the type of paving, the type of benches, because everyone was just looking in the books, and then they choose a new fancy bank or a new fancy lamppost, and it was a mix of everything. So these books, well, and I think it took 4 or 5 years to really to finish this all, but we started to work with it straight away. And I think what was really helpful turned out to be helpful to have this type of these six themes, and they are in a way so maybe abstract or general, that they are really everyone can use them. So because of course we work with politicians, and they change mostly every 4 years, and if they are not from the same party, they will focus on different subjects also in public space. But these types, these titles, they always, they could kind of adapt them to their own goals, or we could help them to tell them, well, you think that and that is important. Like, for example, Bolsius, it was maybe before your time, he was very much into the network and greening, and then Alexandra van Huffelen came, and she was in greening and in the river, and now it's of course the whole thing about the bicycling. And you see that it really helps to make a long-term policy for the city. And I think most of them, the city on the river, you remember this first picture of me in 95, I was dreaming on it, but now I had a chance to make it important we should use the river more. And I think this one maybe needs a bit of explanation, because Rotterdam was really the best approachable city from the Netherlands. You could drive into the inner city in about 10 minutes from the outskirts, and people were really proud of it. And of course it's very nice that you can drive fast through a city, but at the same time there was no way that you could linger on the sidewalks, that you could have benches, that you could have this what we call now the cappuccino culture, having terraces and people can sit outside. There was no way, because everything was traffic space. And it took really, it was a lot of fighting, but fortunately there were some young people coming into the traffic department, and we discussed, and it really, we discussed for I think maybe 2 or 3 years on some of those subjects, and we still now don't agree always, but it really helped. Young people came in and they thought, okay, it's not only cars, and cars are of course, it's always this, it's for the economy of the city, but being attractive and being able to live in a city and having being happy to live in the city is also economy. So that took a real change, and it really helped that in that time we always make pictures from before and after, because people forget. Once it's nice, people think, oh, it has always been like that. But maybe some of you can remember the West Zeedijk, that it was, there was of course all the buildings still from retail, etc., that was taken away, and we made it green. And what was really nice, we have a lot of tram tracks, many kilometers in the city for the tram, and they used to be all with stones, and little stones and big stones and colored stones, but it was all stony. And this was the first one where our alderman said, ah, it should be green. He had it should be green, and it really, because you can see it's such a long distance, it really helped to soften the city. And what also helped, we here we could expose the dike, the waterkering. It's a really important waterkering for the whole of, it's number 14 called in water management, and it really keeps us dry, and that's very important. But we could also expose this whole dike and make it green, and well, letting more longer grass growing on it. And that was really one of the first big changes, and when people saw it, they started to be convinced that that Rotterdam green was also nice. Well, then still people were very much working on the inner city and building. And of course, in the end of the 90s, there was a question from, well, there should be far more people living in the inner city. There is no city life, and you need, of course, people living there. Really, in Laurens Kwartier and areas like this, there were not so many people living there as right now. And of course, you can say public space is important, but people say, well, it's not. We first have to build, we first make the houses, and then the people come. So then you have to find a trick, and we had a new director, and I said, well, shouldn't we ask Jan Giel? And maybe some of you know him, but he's a famous man from Denmark. Oops. Oh, he's not going back. I just show him, here he is. And this is with the alderman, and this man is just thinking, what the hell are they doing here? But Jan Giel was just, he had been studying public life for a long, long time in Copenhagen and other places. And he said, well, if you really want to be an attractive city, if you really want people to stay there and really stay longer, you have to work on public space. And he could prove it by, I'm not going to explain this all, but it was just Copenhagen, which first had one nice street, and then they really, well, extended it, and here you could see how many more people were visiting them, staying longer, and of course in the end, if they stay longer and be there, it's of course again really a spin-off for your city economy. Well, he showed a lot of ugly pictures about the city. You think you know it, but he had this whole range, so the local mayor, the aldermen, everyone was convinced, and we started working on places. Well, you see the changes of the Binnenwegplein. And the case, making them green, was also, they called us the Green Khmer, because we were greening up the city on places which were kind of holy for all city planners, because Rotterdam should be stony and robust, and, well, a bit grey. So this was all happening, and we even designed the furniture for the city, that it was convenient to sit, and not only nice looking. And then, well, if it comes to, if I look back on these things, it's really, you sometimes are too early, and it's in a world of politicians, of governance changing, management, it's really difficult, but you can find your way, and it's really important to keep your own goals, your own destiny. What are you going for? What is important? And for me, it was always very important to work on this attractive inner city or attractive rest of the city. And in that, working on that, you kind of all the time you choose where the politicians have their interest, and that you kind of, well, you kind of bend it how it can work in your public space. And it has, of course, you do have to make sometimes compromises, but mostly they are not so big. And if they're really, I feel that it's not good what's happening, then I will just skip the project. project, I won't work on it. And well, you can only do that for one or two projects, because otherwise it's not a good way. But it really helps to also stick to some of the values which are important. And then, well, sometimes you're not very nice, of course, because you're pushing and nagging people from, hey, but we shouldn't do it like this or that. But if you keep your long-term goal, I think it's worth them. And it felt for me at the same time that in the changing of Rotterdam and the 20 years I've been working here now, I changed as well. I was in the beginning, I think, like you, really anxious, and it should change now. Eh? You don't have time. You're very young. You're going to live, maybe 60 years more, but you want everything to change now. And well, in some occupations you have to do that, but in my field you have luckily a little bit time, so you kind of can move along the tracks and find your way, and I wish you luck with that. Thank you.